crowds are there to meet him. Jesus is making a big splash on the public scene. People are flocking to Jesus. People are crowding to Jesus. What we saw this morning, the crowds were so huge that they just literally hemmed Jesus in. And they did the same in this passage of Scripture. Jesus gets out of the boat at Galilee, and the crowds come running down the beach. We read in verse 40, he returns, the crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Verse 41, and just then, a man named Jairus came. He was a leader of the synagogue, and he fell down. Get this, he falls down at Jesus' feet and pleads with him, come to my house, because I have an only daughter. 12 years old. She's daddy's little girl. And she's about to die. Parents will do anything for their children that are in need. I'm not a parent. I don't understand that. But I've observed that, both in parents, you parents, making sacrifices for your children. And I've observed that in my parents' lives. That for those children, a child that is in genuine need, you will go to the ends of the earth. A child that is in need, you will pound on the door of heaven in prayer. For a child that is in dire straits, as this little girl was, you will do whatever it takes to help that child. Parents, have you made sacrifices for your children? Have you suffered indignities for your children? Have you lost all pride and respect sometime for the sake of your children? Parents, you know what I'm talking about. Here was this man, Jairus. And there's some things we need to know about him to really understand this full context. This man, Jairus, we read that he was a synagogue leader. He was the leader or a major leader in the synagogue of Galilee. He was an important person. He was a person of status. He was a person with great honor. He was a person that everyone would have known. He would have been a minor celebrity in his community. Everybody who saw him on the sidewalk immediately knew who he was. He walked with probably a certain swagger, a certain way that he walked and carried himself because of the nobility of his position. But I want to show you this evening. It doesn't matter who you are. Trouble still comes. It doesn't matter if you're rich or if you're poor. Trouble still comes. It doesn't matter if you're famous or if you're obscure and if nobody knows who you are. Trouble still comes. It doesn't matter if you're a person of nobility or a person that's common. Trouble still comes. It doesn't matter, get this folks, it doesn't matter if you are religious or if you're a heathen. Trouble still comes. The Bible says that it rains on the just and the unjust. How many of you have observed in this world that you can't be good enough to spare you from all the troubles of this world? How many of you know of good families, of good people who have suffered great calamities? I have performed funerals for children who died in tragic or unexpected ways that came from good families. Good families. It doesn't matter who you are, folks. Trouble comes. We know that to be true. Amen. And trouble had come to this man. Trouble had come to Jairus' family. Daddy's little girl. Daddy's precious little girl that he doted on and he loved so very much. Daddy's little girl that he bounced on his knee. Daddy's little girl that he smiled so big when she comes up with her arms open wide to give him a hug. Daddy's little precious girl was lying on death's bed, and Jairus was desperate. He was desperate. And do you also know that when you're desperate, you'll do just about anything? When you get desperate, Convention goes out the door. This man was the leader in the synagogue. He was a Jewish leader. And Jewish leadership looked upon Jesus with suspicion. They looked upon Jesus with skepticism. They looked upon Jesus with mistrust. A lot of them looked upon Jesus with disdain. They didn't like what he was doing. And the suspicion and cynicism that they have early on here in Jesus' ministry turns to out and out persecution later on, even to the point of crying out, "Crucify him, crucify him." And here's Jairus, a Jewish leader, a synagogue leader. But he got desperate. And he had heard about this Jesus and the things that this Jesus had done. Remember, he makes the plea to Jesus before the woman touched Jesus in the crowd that we saw this morning. But Jesus has healed other people, and Jesus has done other miracles, and word has spread about Jesus. And so he's desperate, and so he doesn't care what the other synagogue leaders were going to say about him. He didn't care what the board of elders in the synagogue was going to say about him. He didn't care what the town council was going to say about him. He didn't care what the high priest was going to say about him. He didn't care what the local council of Pharisees was going to say about him. He didn't care about any of those things. Why? Because he got desperate. And folks, when he got desperate, he went to Jesus. And I want to tell you tonight that this world needs some people that'll get desperate for Jesus. This world is in a desperate situation, and the world, literally, if you watch the news, the world is on fire, and our nation is on fire, and things are happening in our nation. And folks, when we look at those things, we ought to say, lift up your heads, because your redemption draweth nigh. I believe that God will send you desperate situations so that you'll get desperate for Him. I believe that God will do that, and I believe that some of the pain we endure and trials we endure are God's mercy to make us desperate for Him. Jairus got desperate. He didn't care what anybody said about him. He was going to Jesus no matter what, because Jesus was his last hope. Verse 41, just then the man Jairus comes. He's a leader of the synagogue. And look what he did. He fell down at Jesus' feet and he pleaded with him. Impending tragedy will humble you. Impending tragedy will make you humble. It'll teach you some humility. Desperate situations will teach you some humility. Here was Jairus. He's a leader. He's a high uppity up in the community. He has the respect of the people. People, as he walks by, I'm uncertain of this, but it is a strong possibility that as he walked by, people of good rapport and civility and understood their station in life would have probably bowed when he walked by. Almost as royalty. And Jairus here is flinging himself down on the ground and pleading. This man Jairus was probably not used to pleading. He was probably not used to begging. Come on. You know the old song from the, 50s or 60s, "Not Too Proud to Beg, Sweet Baby"? Most of us too proud to beg. This man got into that desperate situation. He wasn't too proud to beg. He got down on his knees before Jesus in humility and begged the Lord Jesus, "Jesus, she's daddy's little girl. She's going to die. Won't you please come?" And Jesus did. He was going. He's going to Jairus' home, and that huge crowd that came out to the beach to meet him is now going with him. I think there are some situations where I think there are some situations that have merited our begging and pleading the Lord Jesus, and we just hadn't done it. There are times, folks, listen to me, there are times when we need to come before the throne of grace boldly in the name of Jesus. We need to pound on the door of heaven with tears and intercession and fasting. And you say, well, God hears, you say a simple prayer, God hears your prayer, and go on. That may have some theological credence, but I'm going to tell you what, folks, sometimes you just got to get before the Lord, fall down on your face and beg. And Jesus responded, and Jesus went with the man. We know the account from this morning, what happened as he's going on the way. The woman reaches out and touches him. Power goes out from him. She is healed. We pick up in verse 49. While he's still speaking, Jesus has just told the woman, your faith has made you well, go in peace. While he's still speaking, verse 49, someone came from the synagogue leader's house saying, your daughter's dead. Don't bother the teacher anymore. When Jesus heard it, he answered, don't be afraid. Believe, and she'll be made well. He comes to the house. He lets no one enter except Peter, James, John, the child's father and mother. Everyone's crying. Everyone's mourning. That's what they do. But he said, stop crying, for she's not dead, but asleep. Don't tell Jesus why something can't be. Don't bother the teacher anymore. Your daughter's dead. Your daughter's dead. Verse 53, we read, they started laughing at him because they knew she was dead. No, look at the text with me. Verse 53, say that word with me. They started laughing at him because they knew she was dead. They knew she was dead. They knew. No, you don't know. You see, we think we know stuff. And so we will even tell God, God, that can't be. That's impossible. Lord, I could never do that. I don't have the ability to do it. Again and again, we see throughout the Bible where people tell God what can't be because they know better. Moses, the Lord tells Moses, you're going to go and you're going to tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And Moses says, I can't, I don't speak well. I can't do this, Lord. And the Lord says, who made your tongue? Huh? Again and again and again, we think we know. Don't tell Jesus why something can't be. Don't tell Jesus what you think you know. When Jesus is clearly saying something else, amen. There's a message there if somebody get that. Do you believe that nothing is impossible with God? Do you believe that all things are possible through Him? Do you believe I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me? Then why do we tell God we can't do that? What did Jesus say? He said, don't be afraid, only believe. Believe. This is not wishful thinking. This is not name it and claim it. What Jesus is saying is believe what I've said. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. I'm going to believe every word that the Lord Jesus has said. I may not understand it. My mind may not can comprehend it. My calculator may not configure it. My Google may not can search it. But if Jesus said it, I'm going to believe it. He said, don't cry, don't give up, don't mourn, just believe. Jesus said, don't tell me what is or what isn't, believe. You going to believe the newspaper or you going to believe the Word of God? You going to believe the accountant? Or are you going to believe the Word of God? You going to believe whomever, the news commentator? You going to believe the Word of God? You going to believe the professor? You going to believe the Word of God? You going to believe anything of this world that tells you contrary what Jesus said? Believe. It's not wishful thinking. It's believing what Jesus said. It's believing the promises of God. The promises of God. And I'm going to believe them. And I know that God is not going to ruin His reputation by not keeping His promise. Amen. I'm going to believe the promise of God. And believe in the power of God. Only believe, Jesus said. They laughed at him. Verse 53, they started laughing at him because they knew she was dead. So he took her by the hand, called out, "Child, get up." And her spirit returned. She got up and gave her something to eat, he said. Laughed. They laughed at him. You say, that's pretty dumb that the mom and daddy and the people there laughed at him. We know the people in the room were the dead girl, Jesus, Peter, James, John, the mom and daddy. They laughed at him. Laughter was a little bit different in Jewish culture than it is in our culture. We laugh when something's funny. Laughter is a response to a joke, or laughter is a response to our buddy slipping on a banana peel, something like that. If he doesn't fall and crack his skull, you know, you don't laugh if somebody gets hurt. Laughter was a Jewish response to unbelief. It wasn't ridicule. This laughter that came from the parents was not laughing at Jesus in ridicule. They were not ridiculing him because they wanted what he said to be true. But they knew it couldn't be. Again, I say, be careful about what you know. What does Jesus say? And so they laughed. We see this all throughout the Bible. Sarah heard that she was going to get pregnant and have a baby, and she's an old woman and barren. And so what did Sarah do? She laughed. But she had a son named Isaac, didn't she? The Lord did it. She didn't believe it. She laughed, but God did it anyway. Zechariah in the New Testament, back in Luke chapter 1, Zechariah was told by the angel of the Lord, you're going to have a son, you and your wife. And they were old and barren. Zechariah had a son too, didn't he? Named John the Baptist. And Zechariah, he was mute. He couldn't speak until John the Baptist was born because he laughed. Folks, sometimes Jesus just says, let me prove it to you. Sometimes, now we may not laugh at the promises of God. That's not our cultural response. But sometimes we don't have the faith to believe it. Sometimes we don't have the faith to believe what God has said. It's sort of like blind Bartimaeus when he was encountered by the Lord and said, do you believe so that you can see? And he said, I believe, help thou my unbelief. Hey, we need to pray that sometimes. I believe, Lord, help thou my unbelief. And so sometimes we don't have enough faith believing in what His promise is, and He does it anyway. Don't miss this. Sometimes we don't have enough faith to believe in what He said He's going to do, and so He does it anyway. You know what that is? That's grace. That's grace. That's the Lord in His grace. That's the Lord in His mercy. That's the Lord understanding our limitations. We're just human beings, and we don't have enough faith. But He does it anyway. Grace. He reaches out, tells the child, get up. There's a deep theological point here that I don't have time to explore tonight. But verse 55. Her spirit did what? Returned. That's deep stuff right there. Those three words. Where did the spirit go? From whence did it come? But here's what happened. When Jesus said, child, get up, her spirit, her life, her pneuma is the word, her spirit returned. She got up. Jesus said, get this child something to eat. And they went and got the child something to eat. And then he says, all right, don't tell anyone. Now that's strange, isn't it? Don't tell anyone. What does that mean? Okay, my little girl was sick on her deathbed, and she died, and then she was not dead, and you don't want me to tell anybody. Why was that? Does that make you scratch your head a little bit too? Because remember, across the lake on the other side, he told the demoniac from the Gerasenes, the man that had the demon, said, now go and tell everyone what the Lord has done for you. Strange, it's something different there. But you see, in Galilee, Jesus already had such a big crowd that he couldn't even walk. And it was not time for these crowds yet. You see, the Lord Jesus had a timing. He had a plan when things were supposed to happen. And the crowd had already got too big. Over in the Gerasenes, not so much. Over in Galilee, don't tell anybody. Crowd will grow as it needs to grow. The child who died is now alive. Where do you turn when things get tough? I tell you where you need to turn. You need to fall down on your face before the Lord Jesus Christ in humility. Just sacrifice all of your pride. Get down before the Lord and cry out to Him. Believe Jesus. Not just, as Beth Moore would say, not just believing in Jesus. Come on now, Beth Moore study. Not just believing in Jesus. Believe Jesus. What He says. Believe the promises of God. Believe Him. Believe in the power of God. Daddy's little girl made him get desperate. He would do anything. And he did the best thing. He got Jesus to that little girl. And that's the best thing you can do for anybody. Heavenly Father, I pray this evening, thanking You for the great mercy You show us. I thank You for the counsel You give us in Your Word. I thank You for ministering to us. Thank You for preserving the gospel, the life, the ministry of the Lord Jesus, the good news. Let this gospel, as we continue through it, be alive, alive in our hearts and lives. Let us be desperate for You. We pray in Christ's name and for His sake. Amen. Would you stand?